أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسول الكريم For any community or communities in the world, you have seen it, you must have observed that in interrelationships, they are always under constant review. They need to be reviewed. Where do we stand in relation to other people, other nations, other communities? For example, in terms of education, in terms of social status, in terms of economic progress, you always compare. It's a competitive world. When one man was created, the first insan was created, or the initial stock of human beings was created, they were also in competition with the animal world at that time, and among competition among themselves. All the time, every time, during the history, always there has been a competition and there has been a comparison. And the art of this relationship is that you compete, you compare yourself with peace, in harmony, for progress, for making prosperity, for achieving your goals in unison, in tandem, in integration with the communities. Because when Adam was created and Adam was upgraded, the name Adam itself indicates the meaning of the term Adam is that who can live together. That is why Adam is called a social being, social animal, because they can live together. And for living together, you need various mechanisms of how to maintain peace, harmony, and how to maintain communities, how to resolve issues, dispute resolution. One of the major issues where we failed right at the beginning of our history was that we were not able to resolve the issues. There was no dispute resolution mechanism between, right from the first caliph onwards, there was no dispute resolution mechanism, and even today there is no dispute resolution mechanism. And the basic reason is that we don't take stock of the situation. We don't know what is happening, what is the real situation. We don't understand it. Today we are living in a global village, a small village which has been shrunk by the internet. It has been miniaturized by the technology. We are not living in isolation. We may put any restriction on the children. What is happening in their minds, in their rooms, in their classrooms, in the streets, we exactly don't know. We cannot immunize them, we cannot put them into any compartments. This is an open world. We know, do you know, and do we properly know, have we studied? The Pew studies show that today in the world there are more than 2 billion Christians. And there are about 1.25 billion Hindus. And we claim that we are also about 1.25 billion or slightly more. And there are other communities also. Now in this situation, can you think that anybody, any Muslim can live in isolation? Or can live with any estranged relationship with such huge communities around? And not only they are, different, in places where you don't have interaction. Look at India. Look at the entire globe. We are in constant, every day, every moment in interaction. We are not living in isolation. We have to understand the situation. Now you take just one, let us come out of the fool's paradise. Look at the same study and you see yourself that between 2010 and 2015, 5 years, more than 1 crore Muslims have converted, gone. That means more than 1 crore families. Why? Because we are not understanding. We can't live with in a strange relationship in a family, in a neighborhood, in such a global village, where we are not able to compete in education, in any field. Can you imagine the impact of more than 1 crore families gone? And we still are living in a fool's paradise. That no, we are the fastest growing for what? For what? That's the question. The immediate, I think, urgent need is to understand our own standing, interrelationship. Are we integrated in the family? Are we integrated in the neighborhood? Are we integrated in the region? Are we integrated in this global village, in this world? Are we integrated? In every matter, we keep ourselves aloof. You look at any, go to any wedding taking place among the Muslim communities here or in Europe, you always find only your own kith and kin, your own close relations, or only Muslims. There are other people also. You are living with them. Why aren't we integrating? What is the problem? Let us understand it. Let us understand while keeping faith intact. Let us understand the issue. What is the problem? Why it is happening? And can we sustain this? The example of Spain is before you. After ruling for more than 700 years, now how many Muslims are there, how many mosques are there? Was anybody left? Have we read this history? Why it happened? Let us take an example. You are from the Indian subcontinent, and the first major historical event is when Muhammad bin Qasim came there. After Muhammad bin Qasim, not during his time, after him, when Junaid came, after him, they started building their separate enclaves. Mansura and other places, at Arod, at Sangad, at other places, and now there are only ruins. All those Arabs had to go back, or they lost in any way. Those who survived, how? They integrated with the society. They are still respected as Sayyids, as Shahs. I give you one example. You take the history of Pakistan. One province only, say Sindh. You see the list of the chief ministers, all Sayyids, all Arabs, till today, even today, because they integrated with the society. Murad Ali Shah, Qaim Ali Shah, again Abdullah Shah, Ghaus Ali Shah, Madad Ali Shah. All these Shah are Sayyids, G.M. Sayyid. Those who integrated with the society, they are still ruling. But those who built their separate enclaves, they have vanished. You find ruins of Mansura. Sumeros, they came as Fatimids, Ismailis. They assimilated themselves as Sumeros. They ruled over Multan. The first attack on India was carried by Mahmud Ghaznavi on the Ismailis in Multan. They were ruling in Multan, Sindh. No, this history shows, the latest example is, Spain is not the latest example, even what is happening in today happening in India, in Burma, in other places. What happened in the Balkans? Oh, we have to take stock of the situation. There are three terms which we misunderstand. We need to understand these three terms. Ummat, Ummah, Khilafat, State, and Community. We are intermixing them together. Ummat, Ummah has no boundaries. It's same borders. It has no borders. Everybody, a Muslim in America, in Europe, everywhere in the world, in India, in Egypt, everywhere, they are part of one Muslim Ummah. We have to qualify as Muslim Ummah. But when you only say Ummah, then we go back to the definition which was given by the Prophet, peace be upon him, himself in the Charter of Medina. That definition of Ummah includes Jews, Christians, and everybody who was living in Medina. When you only say Ummah, Ummah includes, along with Muslims, the Jews, Christians, and every non-Muslim in Medina at that time. But when you qualify, you say Ummat-e-Muslima, then Muslims as an Ummah everywhere, they are one Ummah. But when you say state, are you translated as Khilafat? Or whatever you say, Islamic state. A state always has a geopolitical dimension. It has a territory, it has people, it has its own interests. Iran has its own interests, not necessarily in congruence with Pakistan and Afghanistan. Afghanistan has own issues, Pakistan has own issues, Saudi Arabia has own issues, they have their own interests. Whenever you talk of state, then state has geopolitical dimensions. At this stage, if you want to examine the word Khilafat separately, then Ibn Taymiyyah, who was a product of the Mongol invasion on Baghdad, he was the product of the Baghdad debacle. He was a soldier. He was an imam, he was an Islamic scholar, he was a practical man, and he says that there is no concept of Khilafat. I will not go into details, but you read it kindly yourselves. And then he gave the idea that now Muslims in the world can have different sultanates, different kingdoms. And the whatever the designation you give, Khalifa or King or Emperor, he can give recognition to the Sultans. Mahmud Ghaznavi was the first to get the recognition as the independent Sultan. And the different kingdoms, different sultanates of Muslims are recognized. There were different Khilafats, Khilafat-e-Ayyubi, Khilafat-e-Mamlukiya, Khilafat-e-Ayyubiyya in Syria, Khilafat-e-Mamlukiya in Egypt, Khilafat-e-Fatimid again in Egypt. There were Khilafats existing at the same time. But the name was Khilafat, otherwise they were states, conglomerates of states, unions of states. Now in this background, now let us now come to the word community. Ummah, state, and community. These are different terms. Community has a locus. We are a community in America. And we have a locus, local environment, local conditions, local people, native people. The Islamic jurisprudence prescribes that you have to follow the law of the land wherever you are. You cannot violate it. Live with the people. Live with their cultures. When the Prophet, peace be upon him, was told that the people in the Sabayans, the people in the Yemen area, they were not following the degree of prohibition in the marriages. The Prophet said, it's their culture. Leave them. Don't interfere with them. Don't interfere with others' cultures. Don't create a clash of cultures or clash of civilizations. People have been given different colors, different languages, different ethnic appearances. And the Quran tells that they have been given only for the purposes of identity, not for the purpose of religion. And religions are not for the purpose of discrimination. Religions give one important principle, all-inclusiveness. Inclusive. If the idea was to exclusiveness, then each deen would have been separate. But deen is one in which there are three sharia. From Ibrahim alayhi salam to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, all these prophets bringing one deen and different sharia. Sharia Musvi, Sharia Isvi, Sharia Muhammadi. On the same highway, three lanes, important lanes going together. Somebody stopping at some stop and somebody stopping at some station. But three lanes in the same direction, on the same highway, and they have been given protection. The protection, Qibla was changed. Don't interfere with them. Otherwise, there would have been a great interference till today. And the Prophet needed a much bigger area for Hajj. The Qibla was changed. Don't interfere with them. This is a big example. The nations have been created. Word qawm was used when Musa alayhi salam came from Bani Israel to qawm. Maqam Musa. The definition in the modern sense today, and if you look at Quran, is the same. Qaum is that which stands together, who stand together on their survival, on their economic issues, on their national interests, on all their issues they stand together while they have different faiths. They have different beliefs. But as qawm, they stand together. This is the definition of qawm. Because the people who were otherwise divided into 12 subdivisions when they were settled after the Exodus, that they are referred as one qawm and then distributed on the basis of asbat. Bani, asbat, all these things are for the purposes of managing, administration, but as qawm they stood together. Now you kindly consider with cool mind when you take oath of a qawm, and the oath prescribes you have to stand together. Stand together. This is the definition of qawm given by Quran and Islamic jurisprudence. You have to stand by the qawm, whatever qawm you belong to, whatever nation you have chosen as citizens. Now in this situation, let us see how these qawm, how these people show their solidarity on some occasions. In every matter, they show, for example, in constitution, in their other management and other things. But let us take one example where they reiterate every year or periodically their allegiance, their nationhood. Before this concept of reiterating or repeating the national allegiance through certain celebrations on certain occasions or certain days came, And there was no concept of a calm understood at that time. It was very fluid. The exact the definition which is now prevalent for a calm emerged during the 20th century, although there is a definition in Quran also, as I said. All these celebrations of allegiance, of declarations and other things were religious in nature. For example, in England, what we call England today, you can say United Kingdom, you can say the England of that time, there were 147 holidays in a year. Church holidays, not other holidays, church holidays, that people had to come to the church, devoted 147 days, 52 Sundays, and 95 other church holidays, and they have to come and declare their allegiance and they have to declare their faith. 105. King Henry VIII, he realized the issue that 147 days every year going as holidays, church holidays, in the name of religion, he consolidated it and he declared only 27 holidays on which people used to come together on religious grounds. But when King Henry introduced this, it gradually started becoming a secular event, as the national event, as the event of the people of the country, of a nation. Now, in this background, in this situation, and this took place during the Protestant Reformation or the English Reformation, particularly in England. Now, when in America this question came up, they declared just one day as a national day. In 1621, the settlers at that time, they celebrated their first year of settlement when they had been able to grow their crops and harvest them, and they had a boom. 1621. So they first time celebrated the Thanksgiving Day, and it was in October. It was on Thursday. They celebrated in 1621. Now, it has nothing to do with religion. As I said, that it had already started secularizing in the British background. And here it started in a political sense. After that, in 1863, Lincoln declared it as a national holiday. People had started celebrating, and he fixed the day. And initially, it was the last Thursday of November, although it started in October. But when they fixed it, they fixed it in November. Canada still continues with October. They celebrate it in October. Here they celebrate it in November. And then through 1941 enactment signed by Roosevelt, this was 1841 or 1941, you can verify the year, it was passed into a bill. Now this is law, the fourth Thursday. Now it has nothing to do with religion. It is being celebrated as a secular event. But I have seen that many people discuss it on the basis of religion. It has nothing to do with faith. Columbus came here not for faith. The settlers came here not for faith. They came, in fact, for saving themselves from the persecution which was going on in Europe, to take shelter here. It was a sort of an asylum. They escaped persecution and came to America. They settled here and they formed a nation. and they were celebrated as a nation, and it is being celebrated as a nation, and today is Thanksgiving Day. The point is that the Muslims must integrate it while keeping the faith intact, belief intact, must integrate themselves in the society, in the social norms, in the social celebrations, in other days of joy. I give you some example that how the Quran prescribes it. You kindly open on your telephone Surah Al-Ma'idah, ayat number 3 and 5, 3 to 5, 3, 4 and 5. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling that I have today completed your religion. Al-Yawm akmaltu lakum deenakum. And immediately after that, in these three ayat, immediately after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling that I have today made halal for you al tayyibat, and in that very ayat, immediately after saying this, I have made halal for you tayyibat, wa, immediately connecting, tam, word tam is used of the those to whom I have given the book. Here ahl al-kitab is not used. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whom I have given kitab, utul kitab. Why not ahl al-kitab has been used? The term has been opened up, much opened up. It includes Hindus, it includes Sabayans, it includes Zoroastrians, it includes all those to whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the message and gave the book. Not only ahl al-kitab. Ut, at, look at the words. Immediately after tayyibat, connecting with wa, saying tayyibat, ta'am, word ta'am has been used. It's not for other material or grocery. If they invite you at their home, you must go. You must eat. Don't create fuss. Invite them at your home. And the same ayat says that I have made your food also halal for them. It's not one-sided. And then it says intermix with them. The marriages are allowed. Same ayat, same ayat. Kindly see this in sequence. Al-yawm akmaltu lakum deenakum. And then I have allowed you tayyibat. Allowed you tayyibat. It means all these things which are coming now are now tayyib for you. Ta'am. And then Prophet, peace be upon him, the Ahadis show, used to attend their meals, go to their houses. Even though he was poisoned, he didn't stop. He didn't prohibit it. Even though he was poisoned, he continued. There's no prohibition in that. I give you some examples. For example, we are celebrating Eid. We say that it's open house. But how Prophet used to invite them? When the first message was being made open to the public, the Prophet, peace be upon him, asked Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu to invite people, to go to the people and invite them for the food. Invite them. For example, in the mosque, we are having iftar. We not only say that it's open and we put up a board, no. Go to the neighborhood, invite them respectfully and give your intent, show your intention that whenever you celebrate, kindly if you invite us, we'll come to you. We would love to be invited. We would love to come to you. We would like to integrate. Integrate with the society. Integrate with the neighborhood while keeping your faith and belief. This is what the Quran and the Sunnah says. It's open, it's incumbent to live with the community, with the neighborhood. Any definition in Quran about neighborhood or the ahadith of neighborhood don't refer to only Muslims in the neighborhood. Neighborhood includes everybody in the neighborhood. Now, I started with the population figures. You kindly consider that when Basant is being celebrated, we declare it is haram. When any other event is being celebrated, which is even in the national setup in background, I'm not talking about the religious, so far I'm not talked about the religious celebrations, I'm talking about the national, sir. We say this is haram. Then in isolation, now you consider where do we stand and how we can continue, how long we can continue, how can we compare ourselves in this situation with others. Just since we are talking about one thing only, therefore it would appear that as if we I'm emphasizing one point only. There are many other ways how to integrate, but since today is the Thanksgiving Day, that's why I am speaking in this perspective. Same is the case with Holi. Same is the case with Diwali. We don't understand what is Holi, and we just speak about against it. That is, since it's a Hindu festival, we don't like it. You take the background of Holi, Diwali, Thanksgiving Day, Basant. In history shows they are all related to the spring festival of harvest. Since ancient times, they are all connected with the harvest. And this, if we can translate it, is the Yom-e-Tashakkur. With Tashakkur to God, Shukr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He has given us this harvest. How many days in a year we celebrate the Yom al Tashakkur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has given us a good harvest? Look at the economics of Pakistan. First 50 years, every year, the agriculture growth without putting any inputs, without putting in much effort, there's a boom in agriculture. For example, during the Korean War, there were very good temperatures, and there was a good cotton harvest. Whenever there is a good winter, low temperatures, there is good wheat. Do we give any tashakkur? But at least these people are giving tashakkur. Celebrating a national day with tashakkur to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the background of harvest. That we had a good harvest. Last year we had a good GDP. We had a good GNP. We had a good harvest. And we are thankful to God. I don't think this involves any, if this goes against any belief. This is thanksgiving to God in the national sense for the celebration of good harvest, spring harvest, or whatever the background, but you kindly study in history, find it out that it is in that background. Look at the festival of Passover of the Jews. It is linked now with the Exodus, and they celebrate it as a Yom al-Tashakkur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gave us He gave us freedom from Pharaoh. But if you go into the history of ancient Egypt or Bait al-Maqdis, Levant, we find that this was already being celebrated as a day for good harvest. Now that has been linked with this Exodus. But Exodus is one of the greatest events which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described in Quran. And Muslims believe in that. It is our event that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala organized it. Musa alayhi salam executed it, implemented it successfully. Alhamdulillah, thanks to God, He gave the freedom. Now if somebody says that I am thankful to God that He gave me freedom from Pharaoh, and somebody says I am thankful to God who gave me good harvest, who gave me prosperity, and we join in that, I think it is not only good, but it is incumbent. That Yom al-Tashakkur, thanksgiving, is very important, and very important for integration with the society, and also invite them to integrate when we have Yomul Tashakkur, we have Eid, we have celebrations. I think may we stop here? And if you like, I may continue.